Good evening. My name is Ben Taub. I'm delighted to be here with Patrick Kingsley and Manal Kahi. Patrick is the, as has been introduced, the Guardian's first ever migration correspondent, and I have many questions for him about that. And Manal founded Eat Offbeat, and let's start off with if you could introduce what Eat Offbeat is, and then we'll get to questions with Patrick.
Sure. So thanks again for having me, Patrick. It's such an honor to be here. My name is Manal. I'm the co-founder of Eat Offbeat. Eat Offbeat delivers authentic ethnic meals that are conceived, prepared, and delivered by refugees resettled here in New York. So we're basically hiring refugees who are excellent home cooks, who happen to be refugees by status. They've come to the US as refugees. But they are first and foremost really talented home cooks. We're training them to become professional chefs. And then we're delivering their food to New Yorkers in groups of 10 people and more all over Manhattan, Brooklyn, and Queens.
Cool. So Patrick, you are the Guardian's first ever migration correspondent, and you are also, to my knowledge, and I have read a lot of material on this particular subject. As far as I'm concerned, you are probably the most experienced migration correspondent, having reported from 20 plus countries in the past 4 or 5 years for covering everything sort of post 2011. So the Arab Spring created vast displacement and new avenues for paths into Europe via the Mediterranean, both from Turkey and from Libya. One question as a reporter that I have right off the bat is, how on earth do you sort out the logistics for such undertakings from Mongolia to Nigeria to Gambia to wherever? And maybe if you could, as an example, present us with your main character in the book, Hashem, and maybe introduce us to him with a short reading and then tell us how you met him.
Well, does this work? Is it working? Oh, great. Super. And thank you very much for coming. It's great to see so many people here, and to Manal and to Ben. So yeah, good question. Like this. Is that better?
Yeah.
Great. So you never guess the amount of trouble I had with this on Tuesday, but hopefully we won't have so much difficulty. So yes, great question. How do I organize logistics when I'm moving between 20 or so countries in the space of 2 or 3 years? I mean, there were times, I think, when I went to about 10 countries in the space of about 2 weeks. So it's pretty hectic. It involves getting a lot of visas. It involves working with a lot of fixers, the unsung heroes of foreign journalism, local journalists or translators on the ground in various different countries who help connect you quickly to people that you might want to speak to. But ideally, when you're based in a place for a longer period of time, as I was in Egypt for 3 years, you know, you're able to develop connections and relationships with sources over a much more sort of relaxed, at a much more relaxed pace. And as you rightly say, one of those people that I got to know in the course of my reporting, and whose story forms the backbone of my book, was a man called Hashem Al-Suki, who is a Syrian refugee, who I met in Egypt. And we met in quite traumatic circumstances. He and his family had tried to get on a boat from the Egyptian coast to Italy in late 2014. In September 2014. And the reason why I met him was because I was trying to find out what had happened to that boat, because it subsequently sank after leaving Egypt, killing around 300 to 500 people. We still don't know the exact number. And the reason why I got to him was because he was one of the few people who in effect survived it, because he tried to get on, but as he tried to get on with his family and 3 young children and his wife, he was arrested by the Egyptian Coast Guard, and they then spent a week in prison. And in the course of trying to research what had happened to that shipwreck, I met Hashem and interviewed him. And some people you interview, you don't see ever again, and that's that. But with him, I tried to see him more and more over that winter, just because I was trying to understand more and more about the Syrian diaspora in Egypt. And that's how I came to write so much about his story.
But in spite of the fate of everybody who was on the boat that he intended to get onto, he then went on a boat again, having faced various, you know, the circumstances were desperate enough that he was well aware of the risk and was willing to risk his life again to seek, you know, what we'll get to in a few minutes. But if you could walk us through what happened on the second journey, maybe with a little bit of literary
assistance. Ben is teeing me up for a short reading. Just to give a bit of context, amazingly, despite the fact that Hashim had almost drowned several months before attempting this extraordinarily dangerous journey to Europe from the coast of North Africa, the situation is tough enough in Egypt for refugees that he decided to try again without his children this time. He didn't want to put them through what they just experienced the previous September. So the extract that I'm about to read, which is the opening four paragraphs of the book, it should give a sense of what that journey is like. And it gets a little bit messy towards the end, so I apologize in advance, but it should give you a sense of what it's like to go by boat. In the darkness, far out to sea, Hashim al-Suki can't see his neighbors, but he can hear them scream. It's partly his fault. They are two African women, perhaps from Somalia, but now is not the time to ask. And Hashim is spread-eagled on top of them. His limbs dig into theirs. They want him to move, fast, and so does he. But he can't. Several people are sprawled on top of him, and there's possibly another layer above them. Dozens are crammed into this wooden dinghy. If anyone tries to shift, a smuggler kicks them back into place. They don't want the crammed boat to overbalance, teeter, and then possibly sink. It is perhaps 11 at night, but Hashim can't be certain. He's losing track of time and of place. Earlier in the evening, on a beach at the northernmost tip of Egypt, he and his companions were herded into this little boat. Now the boat is who knows where, bobbing along in the pitch darkness, lurching in the waves, somewhere in the southeastern Mediterranean. And its passengers are screaming. Some of the screams are in Arabic, some not. There are people from across Africa here, others from across the Middle East. There are Palestinians, Sudanese, Somalians, and Syrians, like Hashim. They want to get to Northern Europe, Sweden, Germany, or anywhere that offers them a better future than in their collapsed homelands. For that distant hope, they are risking this boat trip to the Italian coast. All being well, they should reach Italy in 5 or 6 days. But for now, Hashim doesn't know if he'll survive the night, or if anyone will. An hour passes. They reach a second boat, a bigger one, and then a third, bigger still. At each new vessel, the smugglers toss them over the side like bags of potatoes. Now they have a bit more space, but they're soaked. They had to wade through the waves to get to the first dinghy, and the second boat was full of water. Their clothes are drenched, and they shiver, and they retch. The person squeezed to his left pukes all over Hashim. Then Hashim pays the favor forward, spewing all over the person to his right. He looks up and he realizes everyone's at it. Everyone's clothes are caked in each other people's vomit. Each is paid more than $2,000 to spew over fellow refugees. It's a vomiting party, Hashim thinks to himself. So I did warn you.
Patrick, these conditions that people are, is this working? Is this microphone working? Okay, great. The conditions that people are facing along this journey and the treatment that they endure at the hands of the smugglers, not just in the sea, but also in the desert, coming from West Africa across the Sahara over 4 or 5 days, or from East Africa, also through parts of the Sahara, you know, from Eritrea through Khartoum and then through Libya. Thank you. These conditions are horrific. Why is it that people are turning to smugglers knowing how terribly they will be treated, having seen, in many cases, family members and friends treated similarly? What are the sort of obstacles that may in some ways be a result of certain European policies with externalization of borders that is leading people to take these routes?
Well, in the first instance, I mean, obviously they're fleeing catastrophe or warfare in their home country, or repression, or in some cases, extreme poverty. So obviously in the case of 360,000 Syrians who arrived in Europe in 2015, they were first and foremost fleeing the war in Syria. But then there are supplementary issues that force them to make onwards movement from the countries that they initially flee to in the Middle East, places like Egypt or Turkey or Lebanon, Jordan, and that's the fact that they aren't given basic rights in the countries that they first flee to. So in most of the Middle East, despite recent legislative changes, refugees aren't really given the right to work in practice. And many children are out of school. Hundreds of thousands of Syrian children are not in school. And in general, they're treated as second-class citizens. In fact, they're not citizens at all, and that's why they're treated in this way. So then, at that point, they start looking further afield. And many people I met tried to go through formal channels, legal channels via the UN Refugee Agency, hoping for resettlement in places like the US or in Europe. But of course, the West is not shouldering the refugee burden that is being shouldered by the rest of the world. I mean, 86% of the world's refugees are outside the global north, outside of the developed world. So that's another push factor. People have got no other way of getting to safety. And that's the point when they start to take on these extraordinary risks by going across the Sahara, as I know you've been reporting on recently, or across the Mediterranean towards southern Europe, towards Greece, towards Italy, even though they know that the dangers of those journeys might well kill them.
There's a great debate going on in Europe at a policy level about whether rescues at sea contribute to greater migration and ultimately to greater death toll. This year was the highest death toll ever in the Mediterranean, with more than 5,000 people killed in 2016, drowned. And that's just sort of the ones that either there were survivors from those wrecks who could then recount what had happened, or the NGOs or military vessels doing the rescue literally watched them drown. The actual death toll is probably far higher. You argue in your book that, in fact, these rescues in no way contribute to the death toll. And I was wondering if you could walk through sort of your argument, and I should have better framed that. The argument that a lot of European politicians make is that, for instance, the vessel that Patrick described, this wooden boat in Hashim's case, is now becoming increasingly unusual because these boats go now that there are rescues happening routinely, the smugglers put people often into these rubber dinghies that are only designed not to get from Libya to Italy, which is about 160 miles, but to get 12 miles out into international waters where the rescues sort of begin typically around 20 to 25 miles out of off the shore. And so the argument that a lot of European policymakers make is that if there were no rescues, then people wouldn't be going to sea in boats that are guaranteed to sink if no one's there for them. I think you made a compelling argument in your book, and I was wondering if you could sort of walk us through what that is.
Well, first of all, I think it is a complex issue. And since I wrote the book, I think there it's become even more complex, and I'll get to that in a second. But basically what I say in the book, and I still stand by, which is that in 2014, late 2014, when Europe said we're not going to continue with rescue missions in the southern Mediterranean, they did so, as Ben says, because they feared it was like a pull factor. It was something that was encouraging, rescue missions were actively encouraging more people to risk their lives. But what I was finding at that time was, firstly, when I asked refugees, so have you heard about these rescue missions? A lot of people were saying, no, we haven't heard of them. And secondly, when you said, well, if now that you know they exist, does that alter your thinking? And they would say, no, I mean, and I would hear countless variations of a phrase like one that I was told in Libya in early 2015, a dead goat doesn't fear the butcher's knife. So point being, they may be in danger at sea, but really the sea is no more dangerous than what they've had to go through, either to cross the desert or what they're experiencing in war-torn Libya, where migrants are treated as sort of subhumans in many cases, or, you know, across the Middle East, where they don't have the right to work or they can't send their children to school and they're living in this sort of purgatory. So that's the first thing. The other thing is that when rescue missions were actually suspended, if you go and look at the data, more people came than ever before, and more people drowned. So in one fell swoop, it sort of disproves the idea that rescue missions are drawing people, more people into these dangerous journeys. That said, having been again on rescue missions this year, I think basically the rescue missions are in a catch-22, because it is becoming clear that smugglers are increasingly putting people to sea on boats that are never going to reach Italy. That said, I simply don't subscribe to the idea that if you got rid of the rescue missions, that would solve it. You would just see many more people die. And my experience of talking to migrants and smugglers is that they're not actually particularly aware of the ins and outs of what the rescue missions are doing. They know that there are boats out there that might pick up people. And those boats are going to be there, really, whether or not there are specified rescue missions, because merchant vessels, according to the law of the sea, have to rescue people. So if there is a boat in distress, as every migrant boat de facto is, then a merchant vessel will pick it up, or the navies that are operating in those areas. So it's a really complex issue. And yes, I really dispute the idea that if you got rid of rescue missions, suddenly the flow would stop. It wouldn't.
Something that I want to bring up that you sort of alluded to a few minutes ago, and this might be somewhat of a provocative question, but does Europe actually have a migrant crisis? I mean, you recently reported you were in Nigeria, and you reported from Maiduguri, where more than 600,000 people have been displaced by Boko Haram, have come specifically to Maiduguri. More than 2.5 million people have been displaced and are scattered around that area, have not come to Europe. In your article, that this came out in November, you described how, in fact, only 3% of the 17 million Africans who have been displaced by war, poverty, climate, and disaster in the past several years have come to Europe, and 94% remain in Africa. So does Europe actually have a migration crisis, or is it just incapable of handling the sort of perception of floods of people, as have been sort of widely reported in a lot of publications and shouted about by a lot of politicians?
I think there has obviously been a crisis, because people, there was sort of pandemonium in Europe, particularly in 2015. The question is, what kind of crisis? Was it a migrant crisis, or was it a crisis of political will?
Did there have to have been a migrant crisis, given the sheer numbers of people that arrived? Did it have to have become a crisis, or might there have been ways to handle the same numbers of people without creating pandemonium and severe economic pressures or social pressures on specific entry points such as Italy and Greece?
So I think that's exactly it. It wasn't really a crisis because of refugees. It was a crisis because of a failure of European governance. And to be honest, a failure of the entire developed world to invest in mechanisms that exist to resettle people by formal and sane means to places like America. I mean, there was a big song and dance out over Obama agreeing to take in 10,000 refugees, but that's actually quite a small number. And so it was a crisis of political will, a crisis of asylum systems not being able to cope, even though Europe is the wealthiest and best resourced continent in the world. Yes, come on in.
Please.
So I mean, as I said earlier, 86% of the world's refugees are not in the developed world. It shouldn't be a tough ask for Europe to take on what amounted to 0.2% of its population.
Who's making money off this crisis? The migration through Africa, through through Turkey. Who's making money off of it? And how did you come to meet some of those people who, in many respects, are regarded as criminals or, a lot of people who didn't have incentives or seemingly good reasons to speak to you, you managed to get them to speak to you. How? And just sort of walk me through how they succeed and what they want and how you met them.
So people making money out of the crisis are the smugglers. Also the companies that build fences and provide security guards to the border regime of Europe and North America. Those smugglers are making millions. I mean, if you think about a boat that goes from Greece to Turkey, 40 people on that boat, $40,000 coming from those 40 people because they're each paying $1,000 each. Maybe the engine costs $4,000 or $5,000. The boat itself costs $6,000 or $7,000. There are a few bribes and there's payment for the people that are driving the boat to the shore and driving the refugees to the shore as well. But people are still making probably $20,000 from each trip. So if you're one smuggler and you're sending three trips to Greece from Turkey every week over several months, you're ending up making millions from that. I think there's a narrative, though, and again, this is something I go into in the book, that suggests that smugglers are kind of evil incarnate and they're people that are driving the migration in themselves, and that they are the root cause of what's going on. In my experience, they're often unscrupulous and cruel, but they're just people who are responding to demand. And often they're people who have other careers. One smuggler I met in Egypt was previously an engineer at a power station. One extraordinary character who features heavily in the book in Libya was a law graduate. So these are people who often had other careers and fall into this because they see it as an easy way of making money, because they see a large number of people clamoring for their services. The flip side of that is that, particularly in Libya, it's sort of gone beyond individuals making money, and it's a way of funding the militias, the many militias in Libya that are, making chaos in that country. They take a cut either of the smuggling going on across their land, or sometimes they're actively involved in the actual movement of people, or they kidnap migrants and keep them hostage and get them to pay for ransoms. And sometimes even the people who form different parts of the government, or various governments in Libya, because it's a divided country, are also involved in all of this. So all sorts of people are making money. I don't think they're necessarily driving the migration themselves.
Cool. So following this extraordinary journey of survival, which in the scope of things can take months or in some cases years, but is really a short-term event, comes the greater challenge of then building a life in a new place. And Manal, you are facilitating that for a lot of people who have come to the United States. And while their journeys have been different through legal means, through with the protections of sort of various bureaucracies, it's still an immense challenge that is only amplified by the political climate here And I was wondering if you could sort of walk us through how it is that you approach prospective candidates and help them integrate and find work with you in particular.
Sure. So I'm going to speak very practically about what we are doing at Eat Offbeat, and it doesn't necessarily represent the entire situation in the US, although it might be a bit representative of the context legally. One of the things that struck me when I was reading the book, actually, is that the context in the US is a bit different than some of the countries in Europe, in that people are allowed to work. Once you are resettled in the US, once you are already in the country, within a few months, you get an employment authorization document. So you are allowed to work, which makes everything way easier, right? I mean, you've probably heard that from people firsthand, but it makes life much, much easier when you at least are allowed to work. Now, whether you find employment in something you like or in something that gives you back the dignity that you deserve, that's a different story. And this is where we come in. What we're trying to do at Eat Offbeat is really hire people who are passionate about cooking. They're home cooks. They haven't necessarily had any experience cooking in professional kitchens or in restaurants, but that's not an issue for us. We're hiring anyone who has that talent and that passion, who wants to be in a kitchen cooking for people, and who is happy hearing from people that they like their food. So this gives them a lot of pride, a lot of, you know, happiness.
How do you find them?
We find them. We have a partnership with the IRC, the International Rescue Committee. They are one of nine resettlement agencies in the US. So we partner directly, we recruit directly through them. They kind of help us find those people who are, as I said, have come to the US as refugees or through the legal process, and who are passionate about cooking, who are looking for jobs, basically.
And Patrick, could you walk through how that contrasts or compares with some of the challenges faced by irregular migrants who show up in Europe with no documents, who then at disembarkation are sort of processed by the Italian or the Greek authorities and have to start from scratch with not even sure if they'll be deported? Or in many cases, a lot of these migrants, for instance, you know, refugees might get asylum status, but a lot of migrants don't get asylum and are told that they must be expelled, but then aren't physically expelled, so they sort of disappear into the black market. And if you could walk through some of those experiences.
Manal was saying that a lot of people arrive in the USA and they've been processed formally, and therefore things are quite straightforward for their integration once they arrive. But many people arriving in Europe have arrived without any prior fanfare. So while they're being processed, many of them can't work. And so that's quite a dehumanizing process. For example, in the UK, where I'm from, the people spend a year waiting for their asylum process to be completed, and they can't work for that whole time. They can't get any education. And then when they come off, if they finally do get asylum, they're then given a month to find lodging outside of the state system. And what that means is that they have a month to get a deposit on a flat, and that means a month to get a job so they can get wages. And basically it's impossible. There's no way they can do that. So there's a big problem of refugees getting asylum in a place like the UK and then immediately finding themselves homeless, so it's not much of an asylum. But I'm interested, just to follow up with Manal, what are the challenges? I mean, obviously it's easy to find work, and there are institutions that can support people once they get to a place like America. But what are the other challenges? What are the emotional challenges? What are the practical challenges of trying to integrate?
I definitely wouldn't say easy. It's not that easy. Clearly, there are challenges such as language, as easy as that. In our case, it's not necessarily a problem. We say that we speak the language of food in our kitchen. So far, we haven't found that language is a challenge. Clearly, it becomes a challenge when you need to make, you know, you usually start a company, you send an email to 10 people, you say, come on Monday at 10 a.m. It's different in this case, when not everyone speaks the same language, or when not everyone has the same culture or the same access to emails or that sort of tools that we use. Another challenge is actually getting, and this is something we've actually had with a couple of our employees, at least in the beginning, they get to the US, they live in wherever they are, but they're not used yet to the way the subway works, to the way they've never used the subway. And we've actually had that happen with one of our employees. And our very, very initial stages, she was really one of the very first. And we had scheduled everything. We had a day happening the next day. We had booked the kitchen, prepared all the logistics. You can imagine, personally, I had spent so much time organizing that day. And then I get a call the night before saying, Manal, I can't make it. I'm not coming tomorrow. I'm like, why? We've prepared everything. She was super excited. In the interview, she was excellent. Perfect home cook. Everything was, on track. So it took a bit of investigation to understand that simply she didn't know how to use the subway. That was the only reason why she didn't come. And she was too proud to say, I don't want to come because I don't know how to use the subway. It's also, a matter of pride to say that I don't know how to. So these are some of the challenges. And this is definitely something we didn't expect, right? Although we probably should have, but it's not one of these things that are lying right there. But these challenges, we're used to ourselves. We probably have Google Maps on our phone. We use it. We find the way directly. It's not necessarily the case for people who have just come into a country where they don't know anyone. They don't have anyone to take care of their kids. And that brings me to another challenge, which is the lack of family or social structures, social networks that could help with kids, for instance. The way we are trying to deal with that is we're providing very flexible schedules, so we're open to anyone. Even if you want to come for 2 hours a day, that's fine. You want to leave early to take care of your kids, that's fine. But that's definitely a challenge in other jobs where you have to be there 9 to 5 or 6 to 10. Other challenges I could think of...
One thing I wanted to ask about was a lot of the people that I've stayed friends with, the refugees I met on the trail who then arrived in Europe, they've often been through really big traumas, either on the migration route itself, mm-hmm. or back home, and it's those traumas that have forced them to flee in the first place. And they don't get a lot of psychological help or emotional support once they arrive. Is that something that you've come across?
Honestly, personally, I can't really speak to that. I'm not sure what type of support. I know that support they get from the government or from resettlement agencies is very limited. It's only the first 8 months that they are here that they receive financial support. Clearly, resettlement agencies do provide some sort of psychological help. They have an employment office that actually is the office that helps us recruit. I don't assume that there are lots of services available where they can receive any moral support. It definitely is very challenging when you don't speak the language, you don't have anyone to ask sometimes.
Do people talk about what they've been through, or is it very much they're trying to start a new life?
So this is one of our challenges as a company. We really try to focus on what's ahead, not on the past, on what stories brought them here. We don't want to push anyone to tell us any stories. And so far, we've noticed that even at the kitchen, although we did think that people will open up and tell their stories, but usually they want to avoid that. They don't really want to dwell in the past. They want to focus on what's coming ahead. And we're really trying to push for that. So even with the media, we try to say, try not to ask those questions from before, try to focus on. And I feel like, and that's again, a very personal opinion from what I've seen in the kitchen. I definitely don't think it's something that can be generalized on everyone. But people do want to forget what happened. They do want to focus on what's coming ahead.
Out of curiosity, in case anyone is interesting, it has a party coming up and intends to cater, where do they come from, and what kinds of dishes are they creating?
So actually, today we have chefs from Syria, Iraq, Nepal, Eritrea, Guinea, the Ivory Coast, and a few other countries. On the menu, we only have 4 countries. That was the first 4 I mentioned: Syria, Nepal, Iraq, Eritrea, and hopefully we'll onboarding more people who are still in their training. They're really cooking cuisines from their home country. Whatever they make at home, everything we do, whatever we do at the kitchen is just helping them kind of elevating that cuisine. So if you order from Eat Offbeat, you're going to be eating whatever they eat at home with their families. It's just a bit of touch from our head chef who kind of tries to make it a bit more professional, let's say. So you can rest assured it's New Yorkers love it so far. but yeah, it's very off the beaten path. Like I said, all these countries, it's not cuisines that you find anywhere else. It's not Mexican or Indian that you can find on every corner. It's very different and it's very authentic. It's the way they make it at home.
I just have one last question for Patrick and then I'd like to open up to all of you. Having been to all of these places and spoken presumably to not just hundreds, but probably well over 1,000, maybe into the more than 1,000s of people.
Probably 1,000.
About 1,000 people in the past 3-4 years. Is there any particular location that you went to that just completely took you by surprise and was utterly unlike what you had anticipated and that really sticks out in your mind? And that can be like for all kinds of, I mean, it doesn't have to be.
The one that's immediately come to mind was the middle of the sea. Because we've all seen the pictures of people being rescued from boats in the middle of the Mediterranean. And so I thought I had an idea of what that might be like, but I don't think anything quite prepared me for the first time I went on a rescue ship 25 miles off the coast of Libya. And you suddenly realize just how big that expanse is. And I appreciate that's a simplistic thing to say, but just the scale of the landscape is quite extraordinary. There's nothing to see until you hit the horizon. And when you're out there and you realize that, you realize how easy it might be for a small boat, which is no more than a speck when you first see it in the binoculars, how easy it might be for that boat just to deflate, capsize, and for its passengers to sort of drown unnoticed. And so that was quite shocking, overwhelming the first time I experienced that. And then just the experience of when you do see that speck and there's sort of a commotion on board the rescue boat and you're wondering like, is that a boat or is it just a jerry can? You're not entirely sure. And then the boat goes a bit closer and then you realize you can just make out the body shapes above the white line of the inflatable raft. And then you get a bit closer and you start to like make out people's faces. And then some of the rescuers get on a little motorboat and go out to meet this refugee boat. And as you get closer, those faces start to become more defined and you can see people's features and eyes and noses and then you can start to hear them. And that, again, is another quite overwhelming moment that nothing can quite prepare you for. And when you finally reach this boat and the rescuers start talking to the people on board, trying to calm them down. Sometimes they can be quite calm. The sea might be not particularly rough and the sun might be out and they might be quite relaxed because they realize they're about to get rescued. Or sometimes maybe they've been at sea for a couple of days. They are utterly exhausted, delirious, and really losing the plot. And there might be a sort of scuffle as people rush to the side of this overpacked boat. And then there's a real danger of a capsize. So it's a really emotional, chaotic moment when you first approach one of those boats. And in fact, the last time I was on it, this story isn't actually in the book, but another rescue is. But I'll tell this one anyway. We got quite close, and they seemed quite calm. But then as the motorboat of rescuers got closer and closer, suddenly there was this pandemonium, and there was this sort of knot of people surging towards the side of their boat, towards the side of the rescuers' boat. And they were sort of just desperate to get to safety. And then from amid this knot of people, this tiny baby emerged and was thrust towards the nearest person on the rescuers' boat. And that happened to be me. So I was sort of turned from observer to participant and just had to grab onto this two-year-old who turned out to be called Kevin. And it was one of the more moving moments that I've experienced.
Thank you. I would like to open it up to questions from anybody out here.
Marcia.
Do you need me to use this? I'm really loud. you need me to use this? Okay. So we were late because we got stuck in the elevator. But
So I didn't hear at the very beginning, but I have heard you read a portion of your book, and I was struck by something when you're talking about Hashim and how you struck up a friendship with him, that you got to know him throughout his, through the whole journey of his trying to get on the first boat and then not being able to get on that boat, being detained. And then you mentioned something that struck me with the last time I heard you read, but I didn't get a chance to ask this question, saying that there was a lot of tension when he was on the boat, and you know, how, you know, would he make it? And I was sort of struck by, you know, how much you felt his story and how involved you became in his story, and how much you're talking about the baby, you know, the observer became the participant, and just sort of trying to keep those lines, you know, were you able to with him and his story, or with any of them?
Did everyone hear the question? Excellent. So yeah, a very good question, because when you're following someone for so long over a period of months, and indeed when I was with him at this very, very tense leg of his journey as he went from Italy towards what he hopes will be safety in Sweden, it was really hard emotionally to keep a distance. And I think I managed to stay the right side of that line. For example, I mean, the closest I came to feeling like I had to intervene but didn't was in Copenhagen Station when he arrived, and it's 2 a.m. It was really, really cold. I think it was sub-zero. And he needed to buy a ticket to get to Sweden on the night train that goes across the short expanse of sea between Denmark and Sweden. And he didn't have any Danish kroner, so he couldn't buy a ticket. And it was freezing. There was no shops open. There was no bureau de change open. And he was really, really desperate. And with my sort of impartial journalist hat on, I felt, you know, I can't get involved. That would somehow imperil the integrity of the reporting. As it happened, I didn't need to get involved, because 20 minutes later, he finally found someone that changed some euros into Danish kroner. And so I didn't need to put my objectivity to the test. But I don't know what I would have done had we had to wait for another 20 minutes. I mean, it would have been very cruel just to sort of stand there in the freezing cold, letting him sort of stumble around at almost the most desperate moment of the journey, so close to where he wanted to go, but yet so far.
How do you find the reporting by the newspapers in the United States compares to your actual experience?
Well, I haven't read all the newspapers, but the reporting that I have read, I greatly admire, and I think often it's better than mine. For example, Anthony Fiola at the Washington Post has done brilliant work on the journeys that people made in 2015, and indeed their integration in 2016. Anne Bernard did an amazing, sweeping narrative about the family of Alan Kurdi, who was the three-year-old toddler who was found dead on a beach in Turkey, and it was the photograph of his body that really sparked a huge wave of both response from individual humans and governments. And the New York Times has just done a fantastic series of reporting on the integration of refugees in Canada. So I'm struggling to think of bad examples of American reporting. Maybe by nature of natural selection, I've only read the good bits, but the bits I have read have been very, very impressive.
Maybe one thing I can add there, because we've been at one point last year, we've been receiving more media requests than we were receiving orders. We're like, no more, no more. It's just to say that the media here, at least they're trying. There's a lot of desire to bring out a different story, so not keep covering everything that's negative around the refugee crisis, but also show out some of the more positive initiatives. So it just goes to say that there is a bit of this interest. It doesn't go to speak about how good the reporting was or not. I'm just saying that there is this interest to cover more positive notes and give out a different story.
Thank you. I think there is a moral dilemma here. Of course, these people have to be rescued at all costs for humanitarian reasons. I happen to have a Greek-American friend who goes back to Greece every year. He's a professor of comparative literature at the Etkin. And I learn from him too, as well as from other sources, that as you know, I think you or know that Greece, the citizens of Greece, are really struggling to survive themselves, and yet these refugees should be rescued and accommodated, etc. Absolutely, but how can we make it possible for both sides to survive? I know it's a very, very tough question, but I see a huge moral dilemma here.
The mechanisms are in place for the rest of Europe to help Greece out. So, I mean, in September 2015, the rest of Europe, or the rest of the European Union, agreed to relieve, so to speak, most of Greece's refugees, something like 66,000 or thereabouts. So far, the rest of Europe has taken in around 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 in the space of more than a year. So the mechanisms exist to help Greece through its two-pronged crises, but they aren't being used. And so it needn't be a moral dilemma, because we in theory have created a series of systems that allow us to both help refugees and help Greece, but they're not being used. And I mean, another sort of good example of that would be, well, in recent months, there are thousands of refugees who are still in Greece who are supposed to have been put into warmer conditions over the winter, but they weren't. Many, you know, around 21,000 were still in tents outside when snow fell in northern Greece in December, which is sort of shocking because that's when they're at their most vulnerable. And so the question is that Greece's fault? Is that the rest of Europe's fault? And arguably, yeah, it's another case of Europe not really stepping up to the plate to help Greece out, because money is there. There's tens of millions that have been provided to agencies like UNHCR and to large NGOs for, as they call it, winterization, making camps suitable for winter, but it just hasn't been properly used. I mean, if it had been, then people would have been taken out of the tents. So I mean, the mechanisms are there, but they're not being used properly. And Ben mentioned the Dublin Treaty. I think what you're referring to is the fact that Germany wants to. Many countries have now said they want to send people back to Greece under the terms of a slightly obscure European treaty called the Dublin Treaty. It's another kind of example of Greece being asked to take on probably a larger share of larger responsibility for what's going on than it should be.
Just two quick questions. I just wanted to ask Patrick. You're very young. I would expect your involvement would mean somebody like in their 40s or so. How did you get started on all this? And the other quick question is, why do these, swindlers that are, people that get them into this, why do they tell them to throw away their passports? That's what I've heard on the news.
So first of all, I apologize for being so young. These guys are very young too. I guess I've had a series of very lucky breaks that I probably don't deserve. But I started off at the Guardian when I was about, when I was just 20, and I'm now 27. So I started in London on the features desk, and then I moved up to be the Egypt correspondent, and then I became the migration correspondent. So that's roughly my trajectory. Regarding the throwing away of the passports, I wouldn't rule that out. I'm not sure that smugglers say to people that they should, I mean, often what I've heard is, often what I know is that smugglers tell them to throw away mobile phones, or to throw away the sat phone, or even to sort of try and sink the boats as they get closer to the rescue boats. And this is largely because there is some kind of folklore or rumor that they're more likely to be rescued if the boat is perceived to be in worse shape than it previously was, or if they don't have a sat phone. And the other thing is that they're told that if they have, particularly in the channel between Libya and Italy, if they have phones or if they have sat phones, they're more likely to be accused of being the smugglers. Whereas often the people who are left to both steer the boat or carry a sat phone or even a mobile phone are just ordinary refugees who have been coerced or co-opted into playing the role of the smuggler as they cross the sea.
I think they tell them to throw passports because it complicates the way they could be taken back to their country. Yes.
They cannot send you back if you don't have any identity. They cannot crush you. They don't know your identity.
They cannot send you back to your country. So if you become...
It depends though if you're a Syrian or maybe if you're from Morocco. So if you're
also, yes,
if
but they don't know your age too, and you're also like there's many reasons that they ask you to throw away your passport. So,
but I think there's probably some people that are actively told to hang on to their passports because that if they're Syrian, then you know that's their lifeline to safety.
Yes, exactly.
Whereas if they're Moroccan, maybe it's a good idea to throw away their passport because they're perceived to be less deserving of asylum.
You talked about reporting that you admire. I just wondered if you have read firsthand accounts or if there are Syrian journalists or North African journalists who you also admire. And related to that question, you mentioned your series of lucky breaks, and I wondered what your relationship is like. I mean, if you feel complicated about being an outsider and telling a story that you must have a hard time relating to.
So two parts to that question. The first one.
About firsthand accounts or sources that you admire
right.
or have found helpful.
There's a great new project that is being sort of encouraged or maybe even founded at Oxford University, where they're encouraging refugees who are academics who have moved to Europe and in particular in the UK to sort of write academic texts. Some of them are writing about migration from a sort of academic point of view. Some of them have got different academic disciplines entirely. That's one project that I'm aware of, sort of on my radar, that seems particularly welcome and exciting. As regards how can I, as an outsider, relate to, and I guess the implication is, in what right do I to have to tell these stories? You know, it's a great question. I mean, it's the sort of age-old tension in Western journalism, where the traditional dynamic is for white foreigners to sort of land in foreign lands and report on things they probably don't completely understand. I think it's something that we have to sort of talk more about, and ideally the people telling these stories would be the refugees and migrants themselves, and hopefully as people start to settle and sort of unpack their lives again and rebuild, we will start to see more and more of these stories. I'd like to hope that by reporting on this particular theme in depth over a number of years and talking to lots and lots of people, I have a greater sensibility than other people, but I definitely agree that the people that really need to be telling these stories are not foreigners like me, but to the refugees themselves. I don't know if Ben has any thoughts on that.
A small defense of the kind of reporting that Patrick has been doing would be, bluntly, I'm sure plenty of, no doubt there will be a lot of great books written by Syrians, probably in German in the next coming years, German or in Arabic, because they're not, very few have come here. But there are other parts of the world where a lot of people are migrating from, where bluntly there is not a functional education system. I mean, in Niger, 39% of the population is literate. In Nigeria, it's a little bit of above 50%, I believe. More Nigerian migrants landed in Italy than from any other country this year. That's not going to produce a lot of the literature, and you wouldn't know this was happening if not for reporting by a lot of journalists who write for publications that you read in the United States and in Europe. So I totally agree with Patrick that I deeply look forward to reading a lot of the great stories that will be written by the people who endured these nightmares firsthand. But in the immediate term, and in certain places that aren't going to produce the same volume of literature that the Syrians are, for instance, I think that this reporting is absolutely essential, especially when you have politicians making decisions based on what's happening, and they won't be informed in real time, if not for newspaper reporting and books written by people who they read.
Very diplomatic. Yes, hello. Have we got time for another question?
We have time for one more question.
Do one more, and then Patrick, you're signing books after? Is that right?
I hope so.
I don't know. There's a pile of pens over there, so buy books and they'll sign them. Yeah, final question.
There's a lady dead center.
There is a project called.
What?
Yes, I had a question, but.
I feel like my friend Max is an important interview. Okay.
Yes, okay. I have a more or less factual question. In your observations in Northern Africa, or I'm sorry, I didn't read the book. I don't know if you traveled in Middle East, but in your observations, what was the distribution of the migrants mostly? What countries or for what reasons were they running away from the war, or was it for economic reasons or social reasons? And for these different groups, if you could see different attitudes, coping attitudes that could help you maybe prioritize if you were to take a limited number of migrants in your country, how would you go about this prioritization process, depending on how they're coping, where they're coming from, what they're looking for?
Lots of big questions there. Firstly, some caveats. I mean, inevitably, in any huge flow of people that largely involves people fleeing from war, there will be people who certainly asylum officials might characterize as being less deserving of their particular asylum. I cast no personal judgment over individual cases because they have to be judged as individuals. But inevitably, that's the nature of mixed migration. It's mixed. You know, there are people fleeing wars and there are people fleeing other things. But I think we do actually have quite a lot of data from UN records and in particular from national records that tells us quite a lot about the character of people that, in particular, this extraordinary wave of people that reached Europe in 2015 and whose stories form the basis for my book. And the data, you know, it's probably a little bit faulty because inevitably data collection always has problems with it. But we know that roughly, I think 85%, you have to check that, but roughly 85% of people arriving in Europe in 2015 were people who were fleeing what the UN Refugee Agency describes as the top 10 refugee-producing countries. What do they mean by that? They mean that they're people who are fleeing genuine threats, and that is not to say that people fleeing the the 15% who aren't fleeing those countries don't have a right to asylum because their cases have to be assessed individually. It just shows you that the general narrative that, oh, these people don't really deserve to come, that's really not true. That's factually false. And then the other thing that I might just add is that we get told of this clear-cut distinction between economic migrants and refugees fleeing war. But as I was trying to say at the beginning of this conversation, really those distinctions are often very blurred. And you may, someone like Hashim, if you read the book, you'll discover that his house was literally destroyed. This house that he built wall by wall was destroyed in the war, and he spent several months being tortured. But once he got to Egypt, and once lots of other Syrians reached Turkey or Jordan or Lebanon, their lives weren't necessarily in mortal danger, but you can't really describe them as economic migrants because they also weren't being given the rights that they are due under the UN Refugee Convention. They don't necessarily have the right to work. They can't necessarily put their children in school. And so it's this idea that people, because they left from Turkey rather than from Syria directly, don't deserve to be treated as refugees. It's also demonstrably false. So I hope that answered your question. And I know that there is a last intervention over there.
Oh no, I just wanted to say in response to the question about are there migrant voices, there was a project called Frontier, which was doing journalism from a migrant perspective, so it's translating their words. And I don't think there's any tension, and I think there are other projects doing something similar. I don't think there's any tension between having this perspective from migrants and having the professional journalists, perhaps more synoptic perspective that what Patrick's doing. But do I have time? Actually, I have like a question that I wanted to ask, but I don't have to ask it if we're out of time. So. I can perfectly well wait.
Apparently we've got time.
So. Okay, so a lot of the way that you talk about Europe's response to the migrant crisis is sort of in moral terms, saying there's an overwhelming need and Europe and the rest of the rich world has the capacity to do it. And you're sort of making a moral argument. And I think it's pretty much watertight, like a cut and dry argument. Clearly more should be done, and it's not. So do you think that the reason that this argument hasn't been accepted is because the argument isn't being made well enough? Or is making a moral argument the wrong tack? Should people be trying to make arguments from self-interest or something else like that? Should we try and not make this a kind of moral appeal to the conscience of citizens and governments?
Well, very quickly. First of all, I feel like the moral, before I comment on whether I make a moral argument or not, I feel like moral arguments have persuaded a lot of people to get involved and to help refugees and to set up grassroots organizations that have gone to the islands of Greece and tried to help people. So I'm sort of reluctant to sort of go along with the narrative that everyone in the Western world is sort of turning fascist and we've lost all of morality, even though that those are genuine threats as well. The second thing is, you have to read the, maybe you have read the book, I don't know. You have to read the book. I don't feel that my analysis is necessarily all ethical or moral. It's also pragmatic. I mean, one of my findings from, you know, my not particularly scientific surveys and research, but one of my findings nevertheless is that people move. People are going to move whether we like it or not. And so just a pragmatic argument for trying to improve resettlement procedures and trying to welcome more people into our divided societies is that it's often those an increase in those formal processes of resettlement that actually decrease the irregular movements of migrants. And just by way of example, I was in Jordan this time last year, and the head of UNHCR there was saying that the people that they'd surveyed a few months before about whether they wanted to go to Europe amid this huge wave of people that arrived in Europe that year, those people who had previously said they indicated they were going to go in a matter of weeks were now saying, actually, we've decided to stay put because we've heard that Canada is trying to resettle even a small number of refugees, 25,000 refugees. And so even this small number of people the promise of this resettlement program had sort of calmed people's nerves. And, you know, maybe someone had heard that their cousin had had an interview for a resettlement place. Maybe they themselves had been told, oh, actually, your case is now active after several years of not hearing anything from the UN Refugee Agency. And so what that should tell us is that even if you don't believe in the moral argument, there are pragmatic reasons for creating legal and safe routes to safety, because they actually formalize the process and calm things down.
Thank you. I'm very grateful to all of you for coming to here, and you all ask great questions. And Patrick will be sticking around signing books for a bit. And I'm delighted to have met and spoken with both of you this evening. So thanks so much.
Thank you.